And there are several examples. Even those people, after the Prophet claimed prophethood, and they said that he was lying, yet his enemies, his foes, they kept their valuables with the Prophet for safety. And this is known when the Prophet migrated from Makkah to Medina, and he told his nephew Hazrat Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, that give these valuables to the rightful owners. Even his foes, even after they said he lied, yet they trusted him and kept the valuables with him. Why? And we have the example that Abu Sufyan, who was the chief of one of the tribes of Makkah, when he went to Emperor Heracles, and asked him for support against the Prophet, and when the Emperor asked him, that do you know of any instance in which the Prophet lied? Or has he done any injustice? And Abu Sufyan, even though he was the enemy of the Prophet that time, he had to reply, no. So why should a person with such honesty and trust and chastity, why should he lie? Let us analyze the various claims made by Orientalists and the critics of Islam against Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. We'll just discuss the major ones. One of the claims made by the critics of Islam is that the Prophet, he lied that he was not the author of the Quran and said it was Almighty God because for material gains. We know that there are many men who claim to be prophets, who claim to be preachers, who claim to be saints in order to lead a luxurious life. And we have hundreds and thousands of examples in this world today also. But if we see the lifestyle of the Prophet, he led a more luxurious life before he claimed prophethood than after he claimed prophethood. He was married at the age of 25 to a rich lady by the name of Khadija, may Allah be pleased with her. And his life after claiming prophethood was unenviable. So if he did it for money, his life should be better after claiming prophethood. Like we see today, those people who claim to be prophets and saints and sages. Furthermore, we have records in several Sahih Hadith, including the Hadith narrated by An-Nawwi in Riyadhus Salihin, Hadith number 492, that one of his wives, Hazrat Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, she said that there were times when fire was not lit in the house for a month or two, indicating that food was not cooked for a month or two in the house. And we only survived on dates and water, and sometimes milk given by the neighbors. And there are various instances, and even verses mentioned in the Quran, that the life was so simple, though he had all the power, he was the leader, he could have led the most luxurious life in the whole of Arabia. That is the reason that there was an occasion when his wives, they protested. And they said that what is the need for us to lead such a life when we can live a much comfortable life? Immediately, there was a revelation sent by Almighty God in Surah Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 29, where it says that, O Prophet, tell your consorts, tell your wives, that if they care for this world, for the enjoyment of this world and the glitter of this world, I will set you free to enjoy this world and give you a handsome reward. But if you care for the life in the hereafter, you will be rewarded in the next life. That means the wives, they objected that why should we lead such a simple life when we can lead at least a much better life. And immediately the wahi was revealed. But naturally, the wives of the Prophet, then they asked for forgiveness and they preferred the life in the year after than this world. We have the example in the hadith of Riyadh al-Salihin, hadith number 465 and 466, where the Bilal, may Allah be pleased with him, said that whenever the Prophet received any gifts, he never kept it for himself, neither did he keep it for the future, and he gave it away to the poor people. And it is mentioned in this very same Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 79. فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُولُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمْنًا قَلِيلًا فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِهِمْ وَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. Woe to those who write the book with their own hands and then say, this is from Allah, this is from God, to traffic with it for a miserable price. Woe to those for what their hands do write and what they gain therefrom. Now imagine if the Prophet would have lied that this book is from Almighty God, and when actually he was the author, there were high possibilities that one day he would have been exposed and he would be cursing himself in the same book. That woe to those who write the book with their own hands and then say, this is from Allah. No human being, if he would have written the Quran and attributed to Almighty God, would have ever mentioned such a verse in the Quran. There are some critics who say that maybe the Prophet attributed the Quran, though he was the author, because he wanted fame, status, glory, as well as leadership. According to Michael H. Hart, he writes in his book, The 100 Most Influential Persons in the History of Humankind, and he analyzes all the human beings from Adam, peace be upon him, till the present time. And he undisputedly, he puts Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as number one, as being the most influential person in the history of humankind. So if he wanted to become a leader, he didn't have to claim that the Quran was from God, if he actually was the author. And Michael H. Hart, he gives reasons for each person, why did he give him number one, number two, number three, etc. And at the end of the biography, he says that it was the indisputable secular and religious influence of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, that makes him the undisputable number one person to have the most influence in human history. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, if he wanted glory, fame, power, leadership, he was so eloquent, he had all the qualities, he did not have to falsely attribute the Quran to Almighty God. He had all the abilities. And if we analyze logically, any person who wants power, glory, leadership, fame, status, along with him is attached good food, fancy clothes, magnificent places, monumental palaces, guards, etc. But if we see the lifestyle of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he mended his own clothes, he repaired his own shoes, he milked the goat, and he did his own household work. He sat on the floor and ate. When he went to the marketplace, He didn't have any colorful guards. He was an example of simplicity and humbleness. And anyone who invited him, even the poor people, he used to accept their invitation and he used to eat whatever was served to him. So much so that his enemies, they pass a remark, which is mentioned in the Quran, in Surah Tawbah, chapter number.